tonight's game. Send an email.
Welcome to the Bergstrom Court at the campus of Minnehaha Academy as TSB Television proudly presents another edition of high school basketball. We have a doubleheader for you here. Girls and boys will start with a classic Tri-Metro rivalry, the DeLaSalle Islanders and the Minnehaha Academy Redhawks. We'll talk more about the matchups in a moment, but let's take a quick peek at the starting five for both teams. For Minnehaha Academy, the home team, they'll start the same five from last week. Chloe Gunderson at guard. Number 24, Sarah Kaminski. Gunderson, number one, she's a guard. Nicole Nipper, number 31 at forward. Number 32, Rachel Warren at guard. Number 55, Maddie Johnson at forward. And for DeLaSalle, they will start Allina Starr, number three at guard. She's a senior. Joy Jones, number 10, senior guard. Natalie Ewell, senior center, number 15. Claire Thomas, number 20, senior forward. And Tyseanna Johnson, number 22, senior forward.
Mike, I tell you what, this is a great matchup here tonight that we have in front of us tonight. And especially when you take into consideration as you inch closer and closer to the sections, you know, a game like this gives you a true test of where you're at, I think.
Considering the caliber of both coaches and their respective programs, and this also has some implications for the new Tri-Metro Conference Tournament. Both teams won their opening round game, but it's being held here at Minnehaha, even though DeLaSalle is the top seed because the two teams met at DeLaSalle in the first meeting. Now, if DeLaSalle wins, they would host the championship on Friday. If Minnehaha wins, then it would go to the next highest seed, which would be Providence Academy, but St. Anthony Village up there, and Minnehaha at full strength, something they didn't have in their first meeting with DeLaSalle, so this may not be a runaway for the Islanders.
No, you know, I would expect Minnehaha to give this DeLaSalle team a real run for their money tonight on their home floor. You know, they have the capability to make things difficult for them, and I think you're going to see a very interesting, very tight contest. And if Minnehaha can keep this game close, you know, especially into the latter stages of the second half, well, I tell you, we could have a real barn burner on our hands, Mike.
That we could. But one thing's for sure, this is going to be a marquee game for both teams, and we talked about sections. DeLaSalle may have to deal with Park Center. Minnehaha, we saw two of their competitors earlier this season at Washburn and Humboldt, so this is going to be a major test for both schools.
Absolutely. I had the pleasure of watching Park Center play on Friday night against Elk River. Park Center won that one easily at home.
DeLaSalle wearing the white jerseys, Minnehaha Academy wearing the red. DeLaSalle has not lost since their 90-64 drubbing at Hopkins. Minnehaha, a few bumps after winning the first seven games of the year, but they've rebounded since, and Joy Jones crashing into Josh Thurow, the Minnehaha Academy head coach. And everywhere I go, there is nothing but compliments and high praise for what Thurow has done. Yeah. With this team and all around.
Yep, absolutely. Won the state title in 2010, was runner-up in 2011. He's done a lot here.
He also is an assistant athletic director here at Minnehaha Academy. Joy Jones stripping Nicole Nipper. She was held to 6 points in the first meeting between these two teams, and that was why DeLaSalle was able to run away. Jones for three. Bullseye. Joy Jones makes the first basket. Here's Sarah Kaminski, the freshman guard, compared to Tyus Jones. And she draws the foul, will shoot free throws.
Nice move there by Kaminski. I think it's going to be critical for Minnehaha early on to be willing to take that ball to the rack, you know, be able to drive the lane, draw some fouls, and get to the free throw line, and get the foul count in their advantage, Mike, if they can do it.
Kaminski averaging 11.6 points per game, bricks the front end.
It's just a willingness to be aggressive, I think, really what it boils down to.
Splits. 3-1 early. There's Allina Starr heading to Auburn. Nicole Nipper with the steal, and that's how Minnehaha beat St. Peter last week. I was here to cover that game. Very aggressive, got into the entry lanes a lot against a slower St. Peter team, got a lot of steals, and they turned a neck-and-neck game into a pretty convincing win, in part because of an 8-point burst by Nicole Nipper. Kaminski, with a no-look to Johnson, almost mishandles the pass, and That's a good example of how one slight miscue can disrupt an entire play.
Yep.
Starr, bounce pass over to Ewell. Ewell posts up and scores. Lisa von Steinbergs told me before the game she may be the X factor for DeLaSalle tonight. Kaminski looking for Nipper. Tyseanna Johnson with the steal, and she has speed. Bouncing over to Thomas. Yes.
Well, I'll tell you one thing. Minnehaha definitely has to limit the transition opportunities that DeLaSalle gets tonight, Mike.
DeLaSalle, a quick team, and they have found their form after getting clobbered in the opening weekend. Historically, they've started slow since Faith Johnson-Patterson took over, usually dropping one or two games early on, but they schedule so many top 4A teams. As Johnson under pressure from Starr, they find Gunderson on the baseline. Swish!
Gunderson actually hesitated a little bit, wasn't sure she wanted to pass that off or take the shot, but then she chose the latter at the last possible second and got it.
Well, Faith Johnson-Patterson chooses to use one of her timeouts early, 15:40 left, and that will allow me to finish up that point. Has started slow, but DeLaSalle will schedule a lot of 4A teams to prepare themselves for tournament play.
You know, and I think in the long run that really benefits them because it just makes them tougher both physically and mentally. And that's so important, Mike, is, like as I said, as you inch closer and closer to those section games, you have to be ready to go at full strength because, you know, one off night and you're done.
That's what I love about the tournament. This tournament, of course, the NCAA, it's single elimination. So you don't have this prolonged, elongated series that can run for 9 months like you have in the NBA.
Yeah.
One loss, you're out, and that's what makes it so fun. Here's Tyseanna Johnson under pressure, finds it open, Joy Jones on the outlet, and the three is in and out. Fight for the rebound, goes to Gunderson. She's under pressure, finds Nipper. Nipper backs off, goes to Kaminski. Kaminski, very adept from perimeter range. Hit a couple of threes against St. Peter to get them going. Minnehaha, that is. Johnson drawing the foul. Maddie Johnson, I should say, on Claire Thomas. We have two Johnsons on the floor and probably will for most of the evening.
A little reach-in foul there.
7-3. And you can go to the backcourt. That's allowed in high school basketball on an inbound play. Here's Gunderson trying to weave around Thomas, finds Nipper. Gunderson pump fakes, goes out to Johnson. Johnson in trouble, avoids the traveling violation. Nipper launching from three, but she's a little off target. Johnson with the rebound. Bounce over to Jones. She stops. They wanted a travel, won't get it. Ewell hits the 15-footer.
Johnson actually had a couple of options there coming down.
Johnson, very much a hybrid Nipper from the corner. Too strong. There's Johnson again. Johnson, this year's nice skip pass. Starr working off transition, can't get it. Ewell with the offensive rebound, no putback. And Maddie Johnson gets the foul after the rebound. I was going to say, Tyseanna Johnson kind of brings a hybrid play to her game.
Sure does. And, you know, one thing about Allina Starr, you know, she has that body where she can just really bully herself in the lane if she wants to. I mean, that's what's going to make her a great D1 player, I think. Don't you think, Mike?
Well, she's a wing. I'm sure she'll play the three in college, but has the rebounding abilities of the forward and the speed that the guards show. Here's Warren for three. That was a little off balance, but high recoil goes right to Kaminski. 9-3 the score in favor of the Islanders. Nipper, 14-footer. No! Nipper had some similar dilemmas in last week's game against St. Peter. Took her a while to get going. Warren's going to get called for the foul once she gets going. Once she gets going, then she finds a rhythm. Person next to us dropped our pen. That's Jam Taylor, the mother of Hazeli Sellers, who you may see later on in this game. Starr pump fakes a three. Goes to Joy Jones. No good. Maddie Johnson with the board. Made sure we knew how to pronounce Allina Starr's name. She shares her name with a certain medical company. There. And there's a nice skip pass to Chloe Gunderson.
Great recognition there. Caught Gunderson cutting in, and she found her.
Johnson for three. No, that's the second time a three-pointer has gone in and out. But there's Allina Starr anticipating, getting the steal, bouncing over to Thomas. You got it.
Just basically took the ball away from her.
And Allina Starr very adept with that. Averaging nearly five steals a game. Gunderson bumped. Wow, used up her step. I almost thought she walked into a traveling violation and turned an ad-lib basket out of that. Gunderson up to six. Starr, runner, gets the bounce. Starr with the first field goal. Kaminski to Nipper. Looking for Johnson. The pass was deflected, but a foul on DeLaSalle, and that's going to wipe away a good defensive play. Very fast-paced game, though. Certainly much more swift than the game I called last week against St. Peter. New players coming in for DeLaSalle. It's Patience Griffin, number 21, and number 45, Amanda Klein. Yep.
Another foul.
And that's going to send Griffin to the free throw line.
That's on Patience Griffin, 5'8 sophomore.
Right, that would send Gunderson to the free throw line. I had the names right, just in the wrong place. Gunderson hits the front end. She averages 9.8 points per game.
New player in now from Minnehaha, number 15, Gracia Gilreath. Hope I pronounced that last name right.
She's usually the first player off the bench for the Redhawks. Gunderson makes both, and we saw this last week. Kaminski stepping up when Nipper was struggling. Gunderson shouldering the load right now while Nipper is still finding her form. Gunderson up to 8 points. Here's Klein on the corner. Johnson works around Gunderson, fires from the elbow, swish! Tyseanna Johnson with her first field goal. Johnson had 21 points in the first meeting with Minnehaha. Allina Starr had 15. There's the press from DeLaSalle. Kaminski pump fakes. Baseline skip. Finds Nipper on the other corner. Bullseye!
Well, I tell you, dangerous cross-court pass there, Mike, but they got away with it and they made it count. Good job by Minnehaha.
They saw the DeLaSalle pressure coming. And we have some more trivia coming your way in a little bit. And that will bounce out of bounds. So Taylor having the generosity to inform us that Gilreath's father is the head girls basketball coach at Minneapolis Edison.
Wow.
And if you want some more trivia, one of DeLaSalle's assistant coaches is Tyray Ross. You may know her as Tyray Brunson. A standout at Minneapolis North under Faith Johnson-Patterson, went to Creighton University. Graduated the same year as Maya Johnson, who's now a Division II coach at Nebraska Kearney, also a newly minted mother.
Johnson got her hand on that and deflected that ball.
Here's Gilreath with the touch. 15-12 is the score. Close game so far. Minnehaha wants to keep it that way. Gilreath. Foul was before the shot, but DeLaSalle is now out of fouls to give.
And again, good job by Minnehaha here, down only three. Still being aggressive, being willing to take that ball into the lane and draw the foul. Very important here, I think, for the Redhawks, Mike.
Both coaches not afraid to crank up the accelerator. Gunderson off the inbound play. And I think that was partially deflected by Griffin. Just remember, Alex, everyone can hear you nod. There's Klein with the touch. Here's Starr. She's left alone from three-point range. Can't hit it. And right position, but a little too high recoil for Griffin to pick it up. Here's Gilreath again. Gilreath. Kaminski guarded by Joy Jones. Tried to bounce it.
Good hustle by Gilreath there.
Nipper. Looking for Johnson, and Johnson tripped up. Johnson, and there's got to be a few puns. Got to be a few puns with there. I'm sure they've heard that a few times. Here's Kaminski launching a three short. Rebound Griffin in position that time. Starr with plenty of speed. Stutter steps. Drives. Swish. Josh Thoreau calls timeout. Allina Starr showcasing her talent. And let's dive into her a little bit more. She's going to Auburn. Originally picked Georgetown, but coach moved, and so did she. Her nickname, Chunk. Wondering where she got that from. Calls herself a very aggressive player, really likes to play basketball because of the fan and community support, as we've seen over the years. And she also takes part in the DeLaSalle Step Team. It's a dance program at DeLaSalle. And on top of that, also a student manager for the football team.
Interesting.
Which she transferred.
Interesting. Very talented, multi-talented young lady.
Also an honor roll student. Jam, you're going to have to project a little further. We have headphones on. And Allina Starr went through some tribulations last spring, lost yep. both of her grandmothers, her great-grandmother just before she won state, and then not long after she won state, her grandmother passed away as well, and two people she looked up to very much. She considered them big role models in her life, and said last year was dedicated to those two, and I'm sure if she wins another state title this year, there will be a similar dedication. We also have some dirt, quote-unquote, on Starr as well. We'll tease that for you and bring that up when we get closer to halftime. It's fun. It's like the dirt cups, you know, the tasty ones. Nipper! Well, can't get the tasty three-pointer there. Joy Jones with the rebound. Starr to Johnson. Those two have played with each other since third grade. But Johnson can't hit the runner. Rebound Gilreath. Gilreath tripped up.
Ooh, that
and Kaminski. Good eye there. That was nearly disastrous. Maddie Johnson out of position. Draws a foul. Will shoot free throws.
You know, I tell you, on that one there, Mike, Maddie Johnson lost a split second when she put the ball on the floor. You know, you ideally, you know, of course she is going to the line. She did draw the foul. But ideally, once you get that ball and you're in that spot, you want to take that ball to the hole right now. You don't want to lose a split second putting the ball on the floor.
One of Tony's common talking points in his time in this existence, in this plane of existence, was post players, keep the ball up because you bring it yep. down, you take it for a bounce, or you pull it in, you give the defense a little more time
yep.
to get to you.
Yep.
And we've seen that happen so many times, not just at this level, but even the pros, college.
Yep.
New player in for DeLaSalle, it's number 13, Kiana Young.
5'6 junior.
Johnson splits. Starr picks it up. Here's Young, baseline J, airballs it. Kaminski picks it up. Thoreau wanted a foul. And he has an interesting perspective on that. Allina Starr had perspective on that pass. Breakaway. Goodbye. And the lead is now 19-13 in favor of the Islanders.
Great anticipation by Allina Starr on that one.
Older sister foul, and I think it's on Starr. Had an older sister at Minneapolis North during their dynasty run. Larea Starr. The foul was on Young, but Starr had the bigger reaction, and with Minnehaha in the bonus, that means Gilreath will shoot 1-1. New player in for Minnehaha, that's Lily Groth, number 20.
Places Maddie Johnson.
Gilreath leaves that possession empty for the Redhawks.
His missed free throws are becoming critical now for Minnehaha.
Johnson for three. Yes! Johnson! The ambidextrous wing up to 5 points. Kaminski was looking for Nipper, but I'd say that was solid coverage. Those De La Salle players could substitute for cornerbacks on a football secondary defensive unit.
Little miscommunication there.
Our camera guy, big Packers fan, maybe there's some room on that roster. Starr to Johnson, back to Young. Griffin from three-point range, short, but Allina Starr, grip position, counted and the foul.
Just so strong, Mike, once she gets in there and gets position, it's almost impossible to box out.
Starr averaging 19.2 points per game, 46% field goal shooter, and 9.1 boards a game, and 9.1 assists per game, averaging nearly a triple-double.
Plays so much bigger than her 5'10 frame, too.
And she understands the lineage she'll be joining at Auburn, which includes DeWanna Bonner and LaCole Willingham of the WNBA. Tyseanna Johnson with the steal, and she's got a breakaway. There's the speed we're talking about, and there's the points. Johnson deceptively quick. The niece of Faith Johnson-Patterson. Yes, I had that right. Those hyphenated names can really throw you off at times. And Tyseanna Johnson picking up on the pass. Another steal, but can't get the deuce. Down she goes, Nipper with the rebound. Warren used up the dribble, has to find help. Finds Groth open, and Groth gets the bounce. There's the danger of full court press.
Yep. Badly needed points by the Redhawks on that one.
That ends the De La Salle run momentarily, but they're up by 12. And Starr draws a foul. Minnehaha had a few to give.
Much to the disbelief of Chloe Gunderson. See the expression on her face.
Maddie Johnson will step back in. The foul is Gunderson's first. Catch, release, scored. Starr to Johnson. Those two love to hook up. High peripheral vision, and when you played since third grade, you're going to develop that sixth sense.
Oh, yeah.
Kaminski, long skip to Warren. And she is poked by Johnson. Here she comes again. Once again, comes up empty, but look who's there. It's her best friend. And Allina Starr up to a baker's dozen.
Boy, they make it look easy, don't they?
It's a shame they won't be playing together in college. Maybe in the WNBA.
Wouldn't surprise me.
Cheryl Reeve, if you're watching this in a few years' time, work out a trade so you can get both. Maddie Johnson can't post up around Starr completely. And the run continuing to mount for the Islanders. Starr in trouble. Nice move around the perimeter, but no three-pointer for Klein. Nipper with the board. And Gunderson, I'm not sure if she knew her teammates were not down court yet.
Yeah.
And Johnson will shoot free throws.
Well, the turnover is really piling up for Minnehaha here over the last 5 or 6 minutes, Mike, and that's one of the reasons for this 16-point lead now that De La Salle is enjoying.
Tyseanna Johnson once considered quitting the sport of basketball early on in her high school career after her brother suffered a heart attack, which nearly killed him. And right, Jarvis came back, but they weren't sure if he could play again, and Tyseanna is so close with Jarvis that if he couldn't play, she wasn't sure about taking on that responsibility, and now both are state tournament champions. Tyshana's won two, Jarvis won last year. Of course, that memorable buzzer beater from Ross Barker to beat Washburn in the Class 3A title, and an amazing story, which continues to get more positive by the page. Starr called for the blocking foul that will send Gunderson to the line for a one-on-one situation.
Two fouls now on Allina Starr.
Jarvis Johnson in attendance, by the way. Maybe we can sneak in a word with him later. Once again, though, Minnehaha, the one's empty.
Yep, those missed free throws have got to be driving Josh Thurow nuts.
DeLaSalle having some trouble hitting from three-point range, and that's about the only thing keeping them in considerable distance right now. But still a long way to go. Here's Nipper. And she found her three-point form, and if there's anybody who can get Minnehaha back on track, it's their top scorer. By the way, you'll like where Nipper's first choice for college is. Allina Starr hits the runner with two defenders in her position.
Great touch. Just great touch on that, Mike.
So Nipper with the touch. Any inkling where she is thinking about college here, Alex?
I have not heard.
Well, she's considering Carleton.
Oh.
Mr. Mayak over here, ladies and gentlemen. He covers the Mayak throughout the season.
That'd be a great pickup for Cassie Koshiba for sure.
Kaminski. Can't hit from long range. We'll share more about Nipper's college dilemma in a moment, but here's Johnson drawing the foul, and she'll shoot a pair. And she draws the foul on her competing Johnson. Tyseanna Johnson, as we mentioned, the ambidextrous wing, has over 1,000 followers on Twitter already, and I'm sure that list will expand when she moves to Iowa State next fall.
Even though I'm an Iowa guy, Ames is a very pretty town.
I've been down there a couple of times.
Be a great pickup for Bill Fennelly's program for sure, no doubt.
Makes both free throws here. Gunderson, quick to Kaminski, and Kaminski will shoot a pair. Double bonus now for the Redhawks. We mentioned Kaminski compared to Tyus Jones, the Apple Valley phenom. Really finding her own, despite being a freshman. On the year, averaging 11.6 points per game. But she's had a couple of triple-doubles already.
Finally, they get both free throws.
And still a long way to go, and it's worth noting this game will not have major implications for section play for either of these schools. Both are in different classes. Just some pride here. New player in for DeLaSalle, number 4, Ellen Leahy. Johnson picking up Starr's miss. Here's Leahy. No basket. Starr. Nice fake. And she draws a blocking foul. It's a shooting foul. They gave her a continuation. Starr, not quite.
A little hard on that first one.
Starr enjoying Auburn in part because she'll get away from the snow. She can't tolerate it. But she can tolerate steals. Carrying violation.
That just shows you how aggressive DeLaSalle can be on defense. They can come at you in so many ways and in so many unexpected angles, Mike. You have to be very, very good and very, very careful in your ball handling.
Gilreath back on the floor. Looking for growth, but that was right into the hands of Ewell. And here's Claire Thomas, but that's going to be a traveling violation. That was the right call. Thomas took a bunny hop just before she jumped. A couple of miscues here on offense for the Islanders. Gilreath over to Gunderson. New player in for Minnehaha. She draws the foul. That's number 12, Jennifer Morozik, and she will shoot a pair. And if there's one issue DeLaSalle's had, it's been a recurring problem of theirs. They're so aggressive, they will often rack up the foul sheet. Minnehaha having some trouble hitting their free throws. And Jan's got to go. serenade her goddaughter over at Washburn. It's senior night over there. We'll have Washburn for you later this week in the Twin Cities Girls Championship. That should be a fun duel against St. Paul Central. Jace Coley against Shanae Chapman. Morozic splits. Starr to Thomas. Thomas can't hit the long two, but she gets her own board. Look at Starr pulling off a couple of pump fakes and then the skip to Johnson. And look out. Tyseanna Johnson laughs it off.
Tyseanna Johnson, 5'10 as well. Just so long. I mean, you look at her and just has those long arms and long body and just so effective in the paint.
Certainly has a long wingspan for a 5'10 wing.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Also a big fan of the Hello Kitty line, the Japanese manga. Bricks both free throws. Here's a chance for Minnehaha, but they can't make the most of it. Oh, Tyseanna Johnson had the steal, but the out-of-bounds line her enemy. Good effort, just not enough real estate. 2:26 remaining in the first half. DeLaSalle leading 36-21.
Be interesting to see if Minnehaha can possibly get it down to like 10 or even single digits here, perhaps, Mike.
Gilreath tripped up and losing the ball to Thomas, and here's another transition opportunity. And once again, the Islanders having trouble finishing on this. We have a jump ball. Possession arrow favors Minnehaha.
Gunderson came in just at the last moment and may have distracted her just enough. Because it looked like, I'm sure she was expecting a clean breakaway. And then when she saw Gunderson at the last possible second, that may have been just enough to distract her just a little bit.
So for 2 minutes now, Kaminski. Gilreath used up the dribble, has to get rid of it. Finds Kaminski. Now they hook up.
Great pass, great recognition.
First basket. Timeout, Faith Johnson-Patterson and DeLaSalle with 1:50 remaining, and a good time for one. DeLaSalle looking a little out of sorts.
Yeah, just a little bit. You know, they had a couple transition opportunities that they didn't finish on. Just a little reckless with their offensive passing. Chance for them to calm down. They still have a nice little 13-point lead.
So let's profile Tyseanna Johnson a little more as DeLaSalle takes his timeout. As we mentioned, an ambidextrous wing. Heading to Iowa State, enjoys playing the sport because you get to play in front of family, friends, and she's had many of them over the years, if her Twitter audience is any indication. You mentioned the niece of Faith Johnson-Patterson, and she and Starr have played under the 400 victory coach since eighth grade. And while we're at this moment, at halftime, we're going to have a little fun here. Allina Starr might kill me when she sees this, but last summer at the Intercity All-Star Classic, she stopped by the boys' game to cheer on some of the athletes competing. Faith Johnson-Patterson was part of the broadcast crew, saw her on video, and had a pretty quick wit about the entire Star War. And Allina, let's just say she didn't like being put on the spot like that. Very comical moment, so we're going to throw that out there at halftime, and then I'm going to go hide. From the island after that.
Ooh, a little over her head.
But that's not a backcourt violation because it was on an inbounds pass and Tyseanna Johnson did not establish control.
Uh-oh.
That's going to be a backcourt violation.
Yeah, just a little sloppiness here by DeLaSalle in these last closing minutes here of this first half, Mike. Gives the Redhawks another chance to creep a little bit closer here now. Minute 39 left.
Should point out Tyseanna Johnson passed the 2,000 point mark earlier this season. Nipper finds Kaminski. Had a three-pointer, passed it up. Nipper won't pass it up, but she's short. Rebound, Patience Griffin. Starr will weave her way through traffic, finds Yule on the skip. Now Johnson. Over to Griffin, left wing, three-pointer off the mark. Live ball, still going. And it's hauled in by Kaminski. She pulls up, can't hit the tray. Gunderson leaps up for the rebound. DeLaSalle forcing the jump ball. They'll take possession.
Thought she pulled the trigger a little bit too soon on that, Mike. You know, even though it was a one, you know, a 2-on-3 situation, she should have held up and see if they could work an offensive set.
1 minute remaining. Griffin, she's not giving up, but still not finding her long distance form. Jones from the corner, swish, her second triple. 39-23, will Minnehaha elect? They're going to elect to push the tempo there, and DeLaSalle with the last touch, so it will stay Minnehaha ball.
Good passing there to Grove, but boy, I tell you, it just shows you how aggressive that DeLaSalle defense is.
That is what has made them so lethal over the years. That's why they've won two state tournaments and came in third in the first year that Faith Johnson-Patterson took over. Took her style with, and it's just like her dynasty at Minneapolis North.
Yep.
Over 400 coaching wins, was recently honored with Cheryl Reeve. I have to get some details on that. Kaminski over to Nipper. Well played possession, but Minnehaha comes up with an empty score out of it. So well played, but Red Hawks couldn't catch a break. DeLaSalle taking a 39-23 lead at halftime.
Mike, you know, again, I think when you look at it from a Minnehaha standpoint, you look at some of these missed free throws down here, and you also look at some of the turnovers when DeLaSalle got on that run. That was really the undoing of the Red Hawks here in this first half, and that's why they find themselves down double digits here at halftime.
Well, we'll pause for a minute, and we'll show you that highlight of ours from last summer. Check the numbers and come back. You're watching high school basketball here on TSB Television.
No good.
He is hammered underneath the basket. Wow. I see Allina Starr, one of my athletes, my son and John Patterson over here.
Yeah, they are having a good time. The 19th annual Inner City
All-Star Classic. Well, Allina Starr is coming from, I think, the prom this year. And so,
the prom? That's what, oh, okay.
No, I'm not. Stop.
To see her, she's dressed in this formal gown, and Faith is giving her a hard time.
Oh.
Desmond Williams at the line, shooting two.
Mike Peden here, and joining us in the booth is Jarvis Johnson, the younger brother of Tyseanna Johnson, and also a varsity player himself on the DeLaSalle boys basketball team. Jarvis, why don't you give us kind of a summary or the elevator discussion on how your team has been doing so far?
Well, we're 20-1, I think. We lost to a team from Kansas by 7, but we're in great shape right now, actually.
I was at that game, actually, Blue Valley Northwest, and if you're going to lose a game, lose it to a team that doesn't play against you in state, even inside the state. So, so tell me about your development as a player. You've been on varsity the last couple of years, and you've already won a state championship out of it. So how have you adapted to varsity ball?
Well, I mean, I think it starts by watching my sister. I've been watching her since I was young. So me watching her is just like motivation for me to go play.
And talk about that for a moment, because we've talked to Tyseanna over the years, and she talks about how much she looks up to you, and that when you went through your emergency, she had considered leaving basketball because they weren't sure if you were going to play.
Yeah.
How does she inspire you to better yourself?
Well, I mean, she looks up to me because I can do some things that she can't do. Like, she has the offensive ability to score anytime she wants. So me, I can just dribble a lot. So with her, with that ability that I have, it's easy for her to pick up the things that I can do.
And one-on-one between you two, how does who's the better player there?
I'm a little bigger, but I let her win.
You let her win?
I let her win.
You let her win. Well, she's very adept herself. But the process with you two playing together, just how have you fed each other's game? Because I'm sure Tyseanna, she's come to see you, and you know, you go to see her games when you can. I know a lot of times you play on the same night, and so that can be tricky. So how does that all work out for you?
Well, I mean, like today, the games we don't have, I just come to hers, and then when she doesn't play, she comes to mine.
Any favorite moments for you, whether it's, you know, you winning state, her winning state, or just something else, you know, from your time at De La Salle that...
I would say, like, doubleheaders. Those are big, because we both get to watch each other play, and we just feed off each other. I take something she does, and she takes something I do.
And I guess, what are some moments, I guess, between you two that you think viewers should know about? Any kind of fun stories or any kind of silly moments? Because I know you two both have pretty significant followings on Twitter. And
yeah.
All, so, is there anything you'd like to share with us?
Not that I can think of right now.
Well, she may appreciate you for that,
yeah.
Keeping her secrets there. But so how is it going to be for you when she graduates, goes to Iowa State, and she's going to be 3 hours away from you most of the year?
I mean, we're close, so we communicate a lot. I think we'll stay in touch closely, though. I'll text her every now and then. But.
And I guess you mentioned you've learned a few things from each other. What is the biggest skill you've learned from her, and what do you think is the biggest asset that she has learned from you?
I would say me learning from her is leadership, and her learning from me is like the little aspects of the game, like just the little things, seeing like a court manager, court leader.
And finally, is there anyone you want to say hi to that may be watching this game?
My grandma, my brother, my family.
Well said. Well, thanks, Jarvis, for stopping by, and good luck as you begin your conference tournament, and perhaps we'll see you pull off that repeat. I don't know if you can replicate the dramatics of last year when Ross Barker hit that buzzer beater, but I'm sure another state title would be just fine for you.
Yeah, it would. Thank you.
Thanks, Jarvis Johnson. And so we'll let Jarvis go and bring in Alex again. So I'll grab the microphone and remind you that you are watching high school basketball right here, as we have the Tri-Metro match between Minnehaha Academy and De La Salle. You can take off the headset now. So let's take a quick recap of the numbers as we'll bring in Alex Nagel again. De La Salle leading 39-23. Allina Starr leading all players with 15 points. Tyseanna Johnson has 10 points. Joy Jones has 6. Claire Thomas has 4. And for Minnehaha Academy, Chloe Gunderson leading with 8 points. Nicole Nipper has 6 on a couple of trays. But that's about it. Kaminski with 3, and very difficult for the support options to really get going. And similar to the first meeting, De La Salle doing an effective job containing Nicole Nipper as Alex rejoins us.
You want the book? You need the book? Look.
Mike, I think it's going to be important here, obviously, for Minnehaha to get off to a good start. You know, they've got to be able to connect on shots. You know, I don't think that they wanted to try to get into a track meet here with De La Salle. That would be counterproductive to what they're trying to do in this game. But yet they want to make the most of their opportunities. You know, make free throws. That's the important thing. You know, if they get to the line, great, but you got to make free throws. How many free throws did they miss in that first half?
They missed quite a few. I know a couple of those one-on-one possessions turned up empty, and that's certainly a no-no in high school basketball at any level, really. We talk about how important they are, but because they account for maybe 20% of a team's total points, some teams will not emphasize it. And that's fine and dandy until it comes back to bite you. Here's Kaminski, Minnehaha wearing the red jerseys. Rachel Warren launching the three. She comes up short. Rebound, Natalie Yule. And Yule has had a quiet game, maybe not as explosive as players thought. But Tyseanna Johnson, she can't hit the three-pointer. Claire Thomas with the offensive rebound. Long two, off the heel. Minnie Johnson falls down, and De La Salle maintains possession. They have possession arrow.
And you know, that's the other thing. You know, another big thing that Minnehaha is going to have to do, they're going to have to limit the opportunities here that De La Salle is getting. You cannot afford to let the Islanders get 2 and 3 opportunities on one possession, Mike.
Traveling violation on Natalie Yule. Yule, by the way, has done some drills and some work with Joel Maturi, the former athletic director of the University of Minnesota, and he is in attendance tonight as well. Maturi had a 10-year span as athletic director, merged the men's and women's programs together at Minnesota. So they're all under one banner now. Nice play from Warren to Gunderson, but Gunderson's layup was too strong.
Another one of those missed opportunities.
Allina Starr to Joy Jones.
2-3 zone here by Minnehaha.
And there's Starr to Johnson, and more free throws coming for Tyseanna. Starr and Johnson are hoping to play in the state tournament in every year of high school. They mentioned how nervous it was their first year at Target Center, but they had a mentor in Brianna Edwards, who's finishing up her collegiate career at Providence Academy, one of the many Division I recruits under Faith Johnson-Patterson.
Yep.
Who's having a word with Starr now. And then they've evolved into effective all-around leaders, great communicators, strong peripheral vision, and they will encourage their teammates every step of the way. Kaminski, long three, short. Tyseanna Johnson with the O board. Starr, fake the pull up. And Natalie Yule was even faked out.
It just shows a prime example right there, Mike, of how easily Allina Starr can get into the lane. Even in a 2-3 zone situation.
I can see why DeLaSalle was the favorites to win Class 3A again in state. After that first weekend, a lot of folks were wondering, were they going to fall off, but.
I still think, as good as DeLaSalle is, I think they'll get a strong challenge from Park Center in that class, in that Section 3. Would not surprise me at all to see a three-peat of that showdown.
And what about Minnehaha? You know, you've got Washburn in the mix.
You got a 2-on-1. Oh, my.
The classic pair-up. Allina Starr scores. She's up to 17. Season high, for the curious, is 33. Kaminski is fouled by Allina Starr. She will shoot free throws. Say, I think we've been sitting next to the Johnson fan section over here. Kaminski has made all their points from the free throw line. They say to make a field goal, and that's how DeLaSalle beats you. They find a way to contain at least one of your top threats most of the time. Joy Jones in a double team. And the full court press pays off, and that leads to, Rachel Warren almost had it, but.
Another one of those missed opportunities.
And now Natalie Yule in transition. Well, I guess they cancel each other out. And an over-the-back foul called on Tyseanna Johnson. Allina Starr has three fouls, by the way, but Faith Johnson-Patterson's not going to take her out.
They haven't, it's only her first. That...
Johnson's first. Well, I'm pretty sure Faith can live with the fouls. Kaminski can't hit the three-pointer. Johnson with the rebound, and she's on the run again. Weaves through traffic, coast to coast.
It's beautiful to watch, isn't it?
Iowa State's going to have a gold mine.
No.
I'm sure you wish you went to Iowa.
I tell you what, you couldn't blame Lisa Bluter for being just a tad bit jealous, but I'll tell you what, that's quite a pickup for Bill Fennelly's program. I'll tell you what, and that. They're going to be so much more athletic with Tyseanna Johnson in that mix.
Question is, who's going to end up in that conference? Big 12 seems to be moving and shaking every year.
Yeah.
Warren in trouble. Jump ball, Minnehaha with possession arrow.
Trips to Fort Worth now and Morgantown. Part of the travel itinerary for Big 12 teams, so makes those flight and bus trips a little longer.
Pretty sure your UCLA Bruins will stay in the Pac-12, though.
Oh, yeah, I'm not too worried about that.
Chloe Gunderson collided with her defender and found a way to score anyway. up to 10 points, but the only Minnehaha player in double digits. And just like last time, Starr and Johnson syncing up to astronomical levels. They can't add another example. And Thomas can't get the rebound in time.
I almost thought Claire Thomas was going to be called for over the back there.
Minutes, 45 seconds. Kaminski looking for Nipper. Now she fires from three-point range, no good. Maddie Johnson, offensive rebound and the cleanup for her first field goal. Minnehaha needs more of that.
Yeah, good job by Maddie Johnson there. Got position well, got the offensive rebound, and got the putback.
Starr, runner, short, rebound, Kaminski. Nipper, long skip to Gunderson, and look at that misdirection, count it!
What a move there by Chloe Gunderson.
Gunderson had an Adrian Peterson-like cut, went left, juked right, and a three-point play chance.
A couple new players here now here for DeLaSalle, number 24, Anna Schaff, 5'7", senior.
And 25, Taylor Tony, making her first visit to the floor. Miss free throws again, but she gets her own rebound. Thomas with the rejection. If DeLaSalle hangs on to win, they would host the Tri-Metro Championship on Friday. And the conference tournament was put in place.
Look at that passing.
I'll explain in a moment. Patience Griffin gets the bounce.
That
and
is
she
excellent.
Finally gets her first field goal after several breaks.
That is excellent passing there by DeLaSalle.
Well, the reason they put the Tri-Metro Conference tournament in, they scrapped the West and East Division, was to create more quality matchups with the top teams in the Tri-Metro. So every team plays each other once to determine conference record. Warren from the corner. Rims out. Johnson scoops it up. Skip to Thomas. Spin move, but too fancy. Traveling violation.
Second time tonight.
So the conference tournament, well, that will do. It's instead of beating up on teams like St. Paul Academy or Mounds Park or some of the weaker Tri-Metro teams, you get more matchups of this caliber. DeLaSalle and Minnehaha, you know, DeLaSalle Providence, they were the two teams expected to play each other in this format. But, you know, St. Anthony Village, we said they had a strong year. Tyseanna Johnson gets the steal after a triple team on Nipper, but she can't finish, but you can't fault her for her push. Players tackling each other, and Nicole Nipper slow to get up.
Yeah, she took a hard hit there, and everybody was diving for the ball.
So we got a few bruises there, and the reason why Nipper is having such a hard time deciding what she wants to do is because she excels at so many sports. She was the number one tennis player in middle school at Minnehaha, and then gave that up for cross country. Thomas in and out. And then Nipper, well, hang on a second. Griffin launches a three and switches it. 5 points for Griffin, 50-31, DeLaSalle up. And Nipper gave up golf for track. And she has a look from San Diego on a track scholarship. Warren drains the counter. And we have a timeout.
Decisions, decisions.
50-34, yes. So a player who excels at five sports, and that's where a school like Carleton would give her the option to compete in multiple sports. She's wearing number 31 for Minnehaha and is speaking with one of the assistant coaches. But to give up one sport so you can go play another sport, and then twice in two examples, and then not quite sure, you know, do you want take that Division I scholarship for track? Do you go to a smaller school to compete in multiple sports?
Well, I tell you, that's a tough decision, Mike. You know, it all really bears down to the individual in the end. I can see where there's a temptation probably to maybe lean toward that D1 school, you know, from a financial standpoint. But at the same time, you know, when you go to a smaller school like Carleton, gives you a chance to specialize in something perhaps. You know, there's pluses and minuses on both ends when you stand back and take a look at it.
And we have a couple more De La Salle players we want to highlight before the evening wraps up. Here's Taylor Tony, and she's one of the players becoming that solid support role. That's what De La Salle was missing in that first weekend of the season. They didn't have the supporting units they did, and it took a little while to find. Johnson, top of the key, switch. Johnson and Starr, the dynamic duo, both at 17. Gilrith.
You talk about the supporting
cast. Bailed out.
Yeah, I think you talk about the supporting cast. I think you include Anna Schaff in that mix, too. 5'7 senior, reserve senior for the Islanders.
Yule and Tony really stepped up there in that role after Maya Lloyd and Mariah Adenine graduated.
Yeah.
Here's Gilrith again. Gilrith on the season. Not too active in the score sheet, but there's a few more years left on the varsity roster. And what has been a very busy night for her and for her head coach, Josh Thoreau. There's the transition tempo of De La Salle, and Tyseanna Johnson, the recipient of the field goal. Kaminski. Holy cow!
Where is she shooting?
Are you kidding me?
She shot that one from...
She shot that from well beyond NBA range. That was about the range Candace Parker hit her desperation three-pointer against the Minnesota Lynx in game two of the Western Conference Finals last fall.
Goodness. That was like way out there. I was just like momentarily stunned when she took that.
Thoreau wasn't kidding when he said she had perimeter range. Griffin shooting free throws. The foul was charged to Gilrith, her third. Here comes Nicole Nipper, number 31.
We've seen a little bit of everything here tonight, Mike.
All right.
And oddly enough, we have not seen a UCLA reference from you.
No.
Or Iowa, for that matter.
Give me time. There's still 10:25 left here.
Well, they did beat Purdue.
Surprising.
Timeout. I'm not sure who. I think it was Minnehaha there because Gilrith was trapped in the baseline. And indeed it was. So that gives us a little more time to actually profile one of the De La Salle players we haven't gotten to yet, Taylor Tony, number 25 for the Islanders. Not one of the stars, as you may guess, but Tony loves to eat and braid hair. I'm hoping those are two separate things.
Presumably, yes.
But enjoys playing basketball because she likes to practice, learn new things, and it really digs the mental and physical preparation involved in the sport. It's a quick sport, so you got to be in shape if you're going to play.
Yep.
Also on the track team, participates in the sprint events, the 4x100, 4x200, and 200-meter dash, and the long jump. Also a volleyball player.
Oh.
And speaking of volleyball-like moves, there's Sarah Kaminski draining another three. She's up to 11. A little shorter range that time, but quick response from number 24 on the Islanders, and that is
shot
with their first field goal. Nipper, that was deflected. Slow down, Griffin. Can't hit the three that time. Warren with the rebound. Finds Gunderson. Minnehaha pressing, and they get the bucket. And Josh Thoreau fired up.
Bringing that pressure deep.
58-43. Minnehaha still is going to need a little more to pull this off, but they are pushing. Taylor Tony, one-on-one, can't post up. Gets her own rebound, and she's fouled from behind.
Well, you know, it just shows you how strong De La Salle is on the boards, Mike, whether it's the defensive or offensive boards. Just so much more height, reach, and it's tough for Minnehaha to adjust to that.
Tony averaging 6.9 points per game, 6.4 rebounds a game. First game against this group didn't factor on the score sheet. Missed all five of her field goals, so would like to correct that, obviously. Bricks both. This is a chance for Minnehaha here. But Tyseanna Johnson almost had the strip. Now Minnehaha will press again, and a blocking foul is called.
Boy, Gunderson, nice play back there, stealing that ball away.
We're seeing some agility out of her that we didn't see in the first half. Kaminski to inbound. Here's Nipper, baseline J. Short. Allina Starr on the board. And the blocking foul before DeLaSalle could run their half-court set. Really fun to see her and Johnson grow. I had the chance to actually watch an archive of theirs. Johnson pump fakes the three-pointer. Schaff thought about it. Now she'll try the runner, and didn't work out. Look out, Kaminski. Bailout foul, and I believe that will be charged to Schaff. But I had a chance to see Starr and Johnson in an archive game back when they were eighth graders at North in a section game against Manila St. Margaret, section playoff game. That was fun to see. Gilreth finding Nipper, close to the baseline, but she stays in bounds.
Got it.
Look out. Traveling violation, and once again, we see one slip up, and that messes up your entire sequence.
Exactly. You know, they get in the passing lane so well, and it just disrupts everything.
Schaff will take a seat, gets an applause from the DeLaSalle faithful. Taylor Toney trips up. And good hustle by Johnson to recover that one. Starr, we've seen, how many pump fakes have we seen from DeLaSalle tonight? They have that facet down, and Patience Griffin has that baseline J down. Struggling at the first half, now up to 8 points. And the lead is now 17. Ewell with the steal. Griffin, one-on-one with Gilreath. And one. Gilreath was not set in time.
And that'll be it for Gilreath, I think.
Yes, that's her fifth foul. She is done. So Gilreath fouls out with 3 points.
She's thinking she only has four.
So Rachel Warr will have to go back in.
Not happy right now.
Griffin, averaging 4.6 points per game, can't complete the three-point play. They try to find Johnson inside, but not even her wingspan could reach that ball. Starr with the strip. Same play. Not the same result, though. Tyseanna Johnson with another tumble. And you see how quickly her teammates converge, and that's something. They have a very strong chemistry with each other. Both teams out of fouls to give now, but the DeLaSalle team, very tight-knit, and it may be partially because of the series of unfortunate events they've had to endure over the last several years, but that has only made their bond stronger. Going from Jarvis's heart attack to there's Griffin missing the three-pointer. That was very scary. Faith Johnson-Patterson getting caught up in the North Minneapolis tornado. Nipper, no three-pointer. Johnson with the rebound, and Gunderson can't clean up. It will stay with DeLaSalle. They say Maya Lloyd's ACL tear during a game against Lakeville North where DeLaSalle got blown out. Last year, they had a broken bone incident with Maria Adunane when she collided with the bleachers during a practice. She recovered in time to play. And everything possible to unravel this DeLaSalle team, they still find a way to persevere. And
it really is an amazing story. They had it was just a myriad of events. it seemed to never end.
This year perhaps has been one of the more calm seasons. I mean, Taylor Toney will take a seat. Oh no, she's still on the floor. She had the foul. And Maddie Johnson making a first in the one-on-one situation. Maddie Johnson averaging 7.2 points per game for the Redhawks. And
number 32, Kat Potterwills, and now for De La Salle.
Johnson makes both, and even if De La Salle, it looks like they're in that position. They're up by 17 with 7 minutes to go. We talked about how good prep work this is, and Minnehaha does have some positives to take with them, because to get this matchup, they edged St. Croix Lutheran, a team that had defeated them in the first meeting back in December. No point, or point blank, no good. Another try for Minnehaha. Yule disrupts the pass, but Kaminski is there for the recovery. There will be a few bruises after this game.
Oh, a few ice bags broken, I can tell you that
much
right
now. We see how
now.
Quickly De La Salle converges. Whoever has the ball, they'll send two defenders in their direction.
Yep.
That will send Morozic to the line. She has 1 point. But with De La Salle being as deep as they have been over the years of Faith Johnson-Patterson, you can afford to be aggressive, because even if you get a lot of fouls, you've got some players who can at least provide some quality minutes for you, including Patience Griffin, who's not on the floor right now, but big night for her. Klein missed it. It will stay with the Islanders, 6:21 remaining. Starr drains the runner. That has got to be a patented move of hers. Several times I've seen her pump fake a long range shot, and she still manages to juke her defenders. I wonder if she took an acting course. Free throw's coming for Chloe Gunderson.
I think it all comes natural to her, to be honest.
Well, maybe she picked that up from the football team or from her time on the DeLaSalle step team.
Yeah, there you go. What? Well, gets the first one. I'll tell you.
Gunderson will be sending a thank you card to the rim after that.
I can feel pretty safe in saying that Josh Thurow is going to be having his team shooting a lot of free throws tomorrow.
And Gunderson banks one in the second time. Same thing, off the heel, and gets the recoil to go in. So. As their season's certainly not over. Toney missing. But there for the cleanup is Natalie Yule.
Another new player in there for De La Salle, number 45, Amanda Klein. I don't know if you got her, Mike.
Well, we got her a while ago.
Okay.
Yule was, again, thought to be the X factor, but turned out to be Patience Griffin, but I don't think the coaching staff at De La Salle minds. And Gunderson missed the pass there. That's going to leave Allina Starr open, and she'll shoot free throws. A reminder, after this game, well, it'll be tape delayed, but we have the second game. I know you got work, so you'll have to leave a little early, but we've got the Minnehaha men and the Providence Academy men in their finals game before the conference tournament begins.
Well, actually, I have the MIAC playoffs to follow tonight.
Well, that too. Well, I'm sure you have to get some sleep to go work anyway.
Yeah.
I tried staying up once. That didn't turn out so well. Came through the WNBA finals, I may as well have been a zombie. That was a long ride down to Indianapolis. Warren to Gunderson. Once again, De La Salle intercepting the passing lane. Starr to Toney. Toney can't catch a break. Starr will pad her numbers there. Klein, triple. Short, Toney with an O-board. Starr will fire from long range. I may sit next to this family more often. I'll know exactly when there's a miss and when there's a bucket. Johnson. Fade away, and it goes in. Johnson up to 7 points, and here's Allina Starr. She may have faked herself out there, but Yule was there to save it. And now Gunderson picking up on the passing of DeLaSalle, and she gets a fast break bucket. How about her game?
I tell you what, I like how she plays. Very alert, knows what's going on out there, very aggressive, as we just saw there.
18 points for Chloe Gunderson. Josh Thoreau will call timeout. 67-51 left. It looks like DeLaSalle will move to 22-3 on the year and host the first annual Tri-Metro Conference Tournament Championship. But this Minnehaha team has a very good chance of making a sixth consecutive state tournament appearance. Yep. And I know Josh Thoreau, very high basketball pedigree. He took the job by accident. He was the baseball coach, and then Lance Johnson, the current boys coach, when he took that job, that left an opening, and they approached Thoreau. He took the job, and now he has a state tournament championship out of it.
Well, I tell you, it shows how adaptive he is. He certainly made the most out of that opportunity.
And he had a busy evening today. He's also the assistant athletic director here at Minnehaha Academy. And if that wasn't enough for you, he also does some officiating for boys basketball. So
keeps him busy.
Like I said, very high pedigree, and Faith Johnson-Patterson, the DeLaSalle head coach, no stranger herself, played college ball at the University of Wisconsin long before her first protege, Tamara Moore, joined the group. And since that time, 19 Division I athletes.
Wow.
And that includes the upcoming Johnson and Allina Starr, who are back on the floor. You mentioned Tyree Ross, now an assistant coach, Maya Johnson, Michigan State. Allina Starr, that's maybe the only time those two could not successfully hook up.
Thought she might have taken an extra step there, but she got away with it if she did.
I'm going to say Brianna Edwards, who we talked about earlier. Maya Lloyd moved up here after her father took a coaching job in Minnesota. Maya playing in North Dakota now. Rachel Warren missing the three-pointer, and it's picked up by Podwills. We'll try to name all of her D1 athletes. As Natalie Yule hits the baseline, Jay, would be difficult. And some wonder why folks like Faith don't get as much recognition as they believe she should. She has over 400 wins, 7 state tournament titles. She is a Hall of Fame member of the Coaches Association. And Chloe Gunderson with a Hall of Fame performance, at least tonight, won't be enough for the win, but
tell you what, it doesn't matter what the score is. She's out there and she's hustling and working for the ball, and it's paying off for her and her team.
And this is a confidence builder for Minnehaha, even in this loss, because section play, they've got some tough opponents to deal with. Anyone they can find to help relieve Nicole Nipper, take some pressure off of her, will be a huge benefit for Minnehaha Academy.
My goodness.
That's the third time Gunderson has made a free throw, and this time she adds a little Plinko bounce. Give her some Plinko chips. I think she could win $50,000.
Yeah, really?
If she went on the Price is Right. Tyseanna Johnson was fouled. And she will get a chance to pad her numbers. And some wonder if because her aunt does women's basketball, or because there's such a high expectation of winning, that she doesn't get as much recognition in the papers as a result. And some wonder if there's some racial bias involved. It's hard to say, deny, or affirm either way, but.
Well, you know, I think you're right. You know, I think the expectations that she has, you know, for herself and her program are very, very high. You know, she expects me. There we go again.
And high expectations can lead to high results. Tyseanna Johnson, though, I will say this. If Fennelly needs to work on anything, it would definitely be free throws for Tyseanna Johnson. Not the strongest of shooters, but we'll see. Kaminski working her way around Starr, which is never an easy task. Warren pump fakes the three this time. Growth in and out. I will say this, Faith does not look for such recognition.
No.
And so whatever you believe is the reason she doesn't get as much press as some think she deserves, She's not out for that.
No,
she wants
no.
to create this extended family.
Yep.
19 Division I athletes. Her entire her team, near 4.0 GPA.
Yep.
Those are the elements that matter most. The records, they're fun to talk about, but no one's going to emphasize that too much, at least outside of the athletic
yeah,
realm.
Yeah.
It's fun to talk about for the reporters and in state tournament time because the folks at 45 don't have the time to research the way you and I do.
Yeah, you know, what this does, it helps prepare them for their future endeavors. It really does, Mike.
That's what high school athletics is about, creating that platform to move ahead. And that's what Faith Johnson-Patterson does so well. And there's Hazelie Sellers, number 14, getting some playing time. She's the daughter of Jam Taylor, who stopped by. Rachel Warren.
Got it.
Would like to have this game back. And also coming in, Akiviana Rembert. I've run out of names here on De La Salle as the reserves come in, but I do think the culture of winning Faith has established at both schools she has gone to is a reason for the lack of recognition, but Hazelie Sellers gets a long range two, and well, now her mother has a highlight reel, so I can use that to as leverage. Her mother was involved. Actually, she's helps with the De La Salle coaching staff as well. Tyseanna Johnson, bounce pass over to Sellers. No, Tyseanna Johnson says, I'll clean that mess up for you.
Sellers, the 5'4 sophomore, getting some good action here in the last few minutes.
I think she took her mother's height. I will say this, both coaches, first-class citizens. Everywhere I go, I hear nothing but positive remarks about the way Josh Thoreau runs the program and his work. Faith Johnson-Patterson, same story. There is not one person on either team who would hesitate to back those two up.
Oh, yeah.
Even their alumni still speak highly of them.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, you go, Starr.
Allina Starr adding another steal. And there's a little fancy move. Took a page out of her WNBA role models there. That brings her up to 22. No question who the player of the game is for both sides. It's your usual suspects for De La Salle and Chloe Gunderson. What a great game for her.
Oh, yeah.
Not a win for Minnehaha. They'll fall to 17-7, but there's Warren. There you go. She gets a three-pointer. And Josh Thoreau will use up his last timeout to get some subs in with 33.1. So let's take a quick look at these sections again. You've talked about De La Salle and Park Center, but since our last timeout, St. Anthony could put a run in there. I don't know if they have the talent or the depth to handle De La Salle. I think you're right. It's going to come down to those two, but De La Salle is certainly the favorite.
They will be. I like I said, I had the pleasure of watching Park Center play this last week Friday night when they handily defeated Elk River, and they just have so much speed, Mike. It amazed, and the reserves, you know, their depth is awfully good as well.
And for Section 4-2A, we've got Minnehaha Academy. You know, we've seen Washburn and Humboldt. What do you think happens there?
Well, I tell you what, I think you'd have to give the edge to Minnehaha, but don't count out Washburn. You know, we saw them play, and you know what they're capable of.
Kevin Anderson said they are ready to make state. St. Croix Lutheran also in the mix, and again, they have a win over Minnehaha, so don't count them out either. There's a couple of sleepers. That's going to be a fun section to watch. De La Salle will run out the clock on a fine win for them, and, well, we're going to have a couple of free throws.
little rambunctious over that last heave-ho.
But this was a fun game, and great to see De La Salle in this last and likely our last game of them. Last game we covered them both season. Final score 77-58. De La Salle with the better overall performance, but a great run from Chloe Gunderson. But I'd say this, De La Salle certainly has made a statement. We're ready to go back to state again.
They definitely look primed. They they look to be healthy, and they look to be peaking at just the right time, and that's what you want to do when you get to this time of the year, Mike.
77-58, the final. We'll see if we can get a quick word with Starr and Johnson in a moment. You're watching high school basketball. Mike Peden here with Allina Starr. Next to me and to her left is Tyseanna Johnson. Big role tonight, just like the first meeting against Minnehaha. How does that prep you for this conference championship on Friday?
It helped us prepare. We know we have a lot of work to do with the remaining days of the week preparing for our game on Friday, whoever our opponent may be.
What were some aspects you did well on, and what do you think needed some polishing as you get ready to play either Providence or St. Anthony on Friday?
Our first half defense wasn't the best, but in the second half we definitely picked it up. As we prepare for Providence, we know we have to play defense. They like to go backdoor a lot, and we let a couple buckets go backdoor tonight, and we know that can't happen on Friday.
What really impressed me, though, despite the flaws, was your ability to pump fake and then set up a play. It seemed like it's almost second nature to you. How have you developed that shot?
Just getting the defense up in the air. They know I like to shoot. They know I like to drive. So triple threat, pump fake and go around and try to create for another player. Usually I catch her back door.
That was something I was told in pregame, how you two have hooked up. I know we touched on this a little bit, but how have you two synced up? Because you played with each other since third grade.
We just have a chemistry. We know where we are on the floor. I know how to get her buckets. She knows how to give me buckets. She's a great scorer, and I know where to find her. I know where she's at all times. Just like any other teammates of mine, I'm just comfortable finding them on the floor.
And Tyseanna, you had a pretty good night. Showed a little speed of yours. It's like kind of a hybrid of the rebounding presence of forwards and the quickness of guards. I think your buddy over there is giving you a little more space here to work with. So summarize your game tonight.
I think it was just running the floor, getting my teammates open, working for us to get better, not just for this game, but for the next game to come.
And free throws, that seemed to be the one thing that hasn't been. So how do you approach that? Try to get that polished up before Friday?
I think just work on it, practice and practice and more practice. This is one game, I can't let it get to me.
And what would you say has been the biggest asset you've learned this season as you two are getting ready to make that transition?
We have to work as a team. We have to get our teammates involved. It's not just about us, it's about a team. So we have to get them better too.
I'll give you a chance to get your word out. I spoke with your brother at halftime. He mentioned a few things he picked up from you. What do you think you've learned from him, watching him play and winning state championships like last year?
I think being a leader on the floor, getting my teammates involved, not worrying about what I have to do, but like worrying about how to get them better as well.
Funny thing is, he said he learned about leadership from you as well. So you two just match up or parallel each other all the time, or what's going on?
It's a brother-sister thing.
So are you going to try and pull a half-court shot like Kaminski did there, or is that not in the cards yet?
Not yet, no.
You did have that long buzzer beater a couple years ago. Who knows?
Never know.
All right, I'm going to let you two go. But before then, I know we had you greet folks. So this time I'm going to give you the floor. Anything you'd like to say about the team, about yourself, about anybody, floor is yours.
Hello, everybody. Go Islanders.
What about you?
Islanders pride.
Well, good luck, congratulations, and perhaps we'll see you in March make another run at state to cap off this fine career of yours.
Hope so. Thank you.
Thanks for stopping by.
Thank you. No problem.